get to making with Jive, boy. It's nice when it hits you, yes.
Hi, and welcome to Hot Topics Live with the Bougie Duchess. And today, my co-host is Danny. Say hello, Danny, to the audience.
Hello.
There we are. Okay, and today we have some really juicy hot topics. Let me start setting some things up and get some of the studio audience in here. I hope you guys are having a fabulous Father's Day. Today's Father's Day. Are you a father?
Not yet.
Not yet. Well, and no woman's ever came up to me and said, look, honey, there's your daddy. So I'm lucky so far. I am unaware of ever becoming a father. But that possibility, of course, exists for a period of time in my life. However, now, in the current state of being, I could never be a father. But, you know, there was that possibility out there. So I'll keep my fingers crossed that one day one of my ex-girlfriends might come up to me and say, look, honey, there's your daddy. And I might have to deal with the fact that she might say, mommy, she looks more like a woman than you do. Because I really did. I loved me a butch woman, honey. I really did. You know, if she looked like a boy but was really a female, oh, there was just something enticing about that situation. All right, so let me get things in order around here, so that we are doing all the right things. So here we go. This is happening now. I'm going to mute this, but I'm going to copy this and take it to my page. Let's see. Okay. Hot topics. With Danny S-U-A-Z. Oh, keep my fingers on the right key. I'm just messing up everywhere. All right. So let's go ahead and control V. There we go. It's fetching a preview. I'm posting this live. And then I'm going to start sharing this to some groups. So there's a lot of groups that I belong to that I would like. Okay, hold on. Let me cancel this. Alrighty. And, okay. Alrighty. Okay. We'll share it in a group. So what I'm doing right now is I'm sharing this to a bunch of transgender and LGBTQ groups that I belong to, so that we can pull in an audience to participate in some of the topics that we've got going on. So the first group that I'm going to acknowledge is the Los Angeles Black LGBT Movement. I'm going to post it there. I forgot to put a little caption in there, but that's okay. Share in a group. Let's go ahead and put a little, I'm going to how come less stuff is popping up now? Okay, let's do transgender groups. Let's get some. All right, THP Kiddos is showing up. We'll post that. Oh, come on. Oh, my goodness. Okay. let's see, Control V. There's some business groups that I belong to, some LGBTQ business groups. LGBTQ, it's not popping up, huh? Let's see. You know what? You may be right. I may have to be sharing this straight from the Bougie Duchess page. So let's go back here. No, let's go over to the Bougie Duchess page, see what I can share from that page. Hi, Frank. How are you? I think Frank has joined us. I'm not quite sure. Hello, Ernesto. Ernesto has certainly joined us. We have somebody from the Middle East that has joined us. I would really love it if I could share in a group. Let's see what we have here. Okay, so. L. Ah, there we go. Trans, kind, there we go. Now it's on. Now we're starting to share. We'll share the page to multiple groups. I'm in the group. Okay. Do you identify as trans with a gender assigned to you at birth? No, I do not. No. Okay. Where do you live? Here in LA, Los Angeles. Who do you know in the KTLA? Okay. F-R-A-N-C-H, it's one and the same, Francesca, Oz, I agree to the rules, submit, okay, all right, fine, let's see, share in a group, there we go, let's L, okay. LGBTQ Los Angeles, Control V. I usually try and get all of this done. Oh, it's making me join another group. All right, I live in LA. Invite your LA area friends. Sure, yes. Okay, LA. Submit. Okay. Share in a group. Now, I don't know why these groups are all popping up here and they don't pop up in my other ones. Let's see. New Orleans ladies. Those are my girlfriends. I spent so much time in New Orleans. Ah, let me share them as me, and maybe the shares will go through. What? You don't like the whip group?
I do.
Okay. Where are we at? Oh, we started a watch party. Oh, gee whiz. I didn't mean to do that, but it's okay. Let's go back to the Bougie Duchess. Okay. All right. Anyway, so let's get back to the topics at hand. All right. Okay. So here we are. We're live. Going to go ahead and open up the page. How come I'm not hearing anything? Because I've turned the volume off. That's perfect. Alrighty. So, let us start with the first. Oh, does that? I don't know. Can I end the video from here, maybe? No, I don't know. Let's go back. I think I need to stay here on this page also. It's okay. I can open up multiple pages. I'm good at that. I open up multiple pages. there's a lot. It's okay. It's all good. We're doing all right. So, here's some of the watch groups going on. Gorgeous. Look at Wano. Oh my gosh. Gorgeous. Okay. So, I think the first topic we're going to start addressing. Juneteenth and the continuation of a systemic prejudice in the United States of America. Now, many people don't know what Juneteenth is. And Juneteenth really is the acknowledgement of criminal behavior gone awry in the South. Because 2 years after the Civil War, the government had to issue an order. Because African Americans did not know that they were free, and there were people in the South maintaining slavery 2 years after the Civil War. So, and I think I have a document here in which I've got some facts, okay? So we're not going to be spitting out conjecture or fraudulent information. No, honey. Here at the Bougie Duchess, Francesca Oz, she does her homework. I may not be in school anymore, but I certainly know how to do my research. Okay, so here in the United States, there's more than one Independence Day, okay? There are many Independence Days. There's Cinco de Mayo, June 19th. General Gordon Granger rode into Galveston, Texas, and announced to enslaved people that they were now free. Since then, June 19th has been celebrated as Juneteenth across the nation. Now, I think that right there is a little bit of bullshit. I have a tendency of being able to smell a lie. It's got a distinct odor. It smells like bullshit. But I think today we can honestly say that most of America is aware of Juneteenth. And that is a step in the right direction, if you ask me. Now, I'm sure if you ask a Klansman, their views on this are a little different. But see, I don't give two shits about what their views are. I respect the right for them to have views. I don't have to like it. But the same right that is afforded to them needs to be afforded to me and to my brother here. Equally straight across the board, without discrimination. And see, for some reason, my white brother there would like to deprive us of our rights to freedom, as they did to the African American population directly after the Civil War. Now, I believe that this created a systemic situation that still exists today. So that's what we're going to be talking about. The systemic situation of prejudice. We're not talking about racism. We're just talking about prejudice. We're talking about profiling. We're talking about the very things, the very essence that keeps us in place and from growing as a true community. See, because when you separate and you divide and you, it's easier for you to keep control of smaller groups than it is when these smaller groups decide to unite. And what I mean by unite is people of color, brown, black, yellow. These communities, if we started to unite, we would certainly outnumber our white brothers, and we could effect some type of change in this country. But they keep using a systemic situation to keep us divided. And that is what I'd like to address today on Hot Topics. Now, enslaved people had already been emancipated. They just didn't know it. So one of the reasons that they didn't know it is A, many of them could not read or write. B, many of them did not have access to any type of news as to what was going on with the, because when you're a slave and the plantation is your world, the only information you're getting is the information that the master allows across the front door. And they kept a tight grip on whatever information came across the front door. So there's a lot of information that can be found out about Juneteenth, and I suggest that every individual become educated on true American history. Not that George Washington history, chop down the apple tree, I can, or a cherry tree, chop down a cherry tree, I cannot tell a lie kind of history. Because see, if you're buying into that kind of history, you are part of the problem. If you believe that George Washington could not lie, you are part of the problem. Because not only was this man a liar, he was a tax evader, and if you're not aware, he was a British citizen and was considered a traitor. Had he not won the Revolutionary War, he would have been hung and quartered as such. Okay, let me get off my soapbox. Let me back down a little bit. Because you all didn't come here for that.
No.
Did you?
No, I didn't.
Did you come here for an American history, a colonial history lesson? Did you come here for that, Danny?
Definitely a good part of it.
A good part of it. I see. I see. Okay. So let's get back to what we're really doing here. Okay. Alrighty. So, hi Jeff. Oh, look at all the people that have joined us. Hi Neil.
No.
Oh my goodness. Alrighty. Hi Patrick. Hi Ricky. Thank you guys for joining us. Wave at everybody. Come on. There you go. Alrighty. So, we're talking about the systemic prejudice here in the United States, and I think it permeates into our legal system. So I think one of the problems with Juneteenth is once they did announce in the South, and I think it was quite a few states. It was Texas. I'm positive Mississippi was in the group of states that did not inform slaves that they were free and kept them in that situation. But, you know, once this happened and they, you know, freed the slaves, now they were forced into a situation where they worked for lower wages than any other individual, because there wasn't any minimum wage going back on.
Right.
Back in those days. So that was part of the systemic problem that was going on. And then on top of that, when they created a police force, they did not include African Americans in this police force. So there was a police force that was instituted in the South that specifically targeted, see, because the 13th Amendment was the loophole that allowed for white Americans to still enslave African Americans. Because, see, you could, if you arrested an African American and convicted him, you could strip him of his rights and you place him on a chain gang, and now he is working for free. And now you can hire that chain gang out to all of these farms in the South where they need just cheap labor. And they found a systemic way around the issue and started a whole new culture of incarceration of our black brothers. And for me, that needs to be acknowledged, that needs to be rectified. These people, of course, have long since been dead, so you can't give them reparations, but God knows, if they were still alive, the amount of money that they would deserve is phenomenal, you know. Many people had to just participate in lying to the judicial system in order to allow this systemic situation to happen. It's a travesty of what we call justice, you know. It's hard to believe in an American system that is built on these types of principles.
Well, you bring up a lot of good points, and I guess the first that comes to mind right now is the idea that it is as much of a race problem as much as it is a class problem, where the ideas behind getting this, like, well, first of all, like, racism and all of that has, like, evolved, you know, like, into, like, microaggressions or outright, like, kind of, you know, like, criminal acts against a certain race. So it's always been, like, prioritization of capitalistic ideals in terms of how much can I, like, what can I do in order to maximize my profits and minimize my costs, which, of course, you explained the movement into using people that were incarcerated, mostly black people and people of color, in order to use that system so that they, since they wouldn't have to pay them anything or pay them very little, they were already minimizing their costs and maximizing their profits. So it gives the picture of capitalist America and what it is that the government actually centers around, which is money, as well as the people that are being exploited, which in these cases are usually the, of course, poor people that are in need of the bare minimum, and also people of color, mostly black people that are also, like, mostly, like, incarcerated, I would say, you know. So there's a bunch of different variables that have to be addressed. You're right, knowledge is power, and in order to be able to do something about it, first you have to learn about it and acknowledge it. So the little brief lesson in colonial, like, history, the colonial history of America and how it is that kind of little systems and institutions came to place was definitely a good starting point for many people, because I know, as somebody like me personally, as a person that didn't really pay attention during high school, like, history.
I never went to high school.
Oh my goodness.
You went to high school? Oh my God, you went to high school?
I didn't graduate, but that's all, you know, like, that's just a clear indication of what it is that I put into my work. But it's definitely, like, Juneteenth coming, like, kind of coming up into a forefront is definitely, like you said, a good starting point. And moving in the right direction, but there's still a lot more to be addressed, especially in this political climate where there is even more division happening. Or at least we're being shown what it is that people truly believe when they say they support one person or the other. So there's also that too. I think there's just like a lot of variables that add on to prejudice as a whole, whether it's through race, whether it's through sexual orientation, whether it's through gender. humans have a typical need to want to categorize things.
Very well understood. I remember when I was I took a lot of history classes when I was attending Pierce College, and one of the things that I came to understood, and the professor, the department chair, Professor McMillan, he said, just remember one thing: history is always written by the winner, and he says so. Therefore, it's going to be skewed in their favor.
Right.
You know, and so you're going to hear the, you know, the better side of their version of history. Mm-hmm. But there's always another side to that version of history. And so, you know, a lot of times, because I tutored in history, so a lot of times when students would come to me and they were having trouble with U.S. history and they'd be, oh, I'm so bored, it's blah, 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 blah. I would teach it from, because everybody loves the scandal. So I would teach it. I said, well, you know, let me teach it to you from the other side.
Right.
And they would look at me and they would say, I don't understand. And I said, well, you know, from, you know, the colonial side. America was a colony of Great Britain, which means we had a king. And everybody looked at me and they said, no, we never had a king. And I said, no. See, that's where you have forgotten and history has kind of been erased.
Yeah.
While we were colonies of Great Britain, King George was the king of America. Mm-hmm. And don't you forget that. And George Washington was a rogue tax evader and traitor to the crown. Mm-hmm. And when they signed that Declaration of Independence, see, they call it a Declaration of Independence, but when it hit King George, he said it was a declaration of treason and signed death warrants for all of those people. And all of a sudden, these students sat up and looked at me. And now, history became interesting.
Right. We live for the drama.
You live for the drama, honey. And I think because we whitewashed history and anesthetized it, mm-hmm. and made it so clean and leave it to beaver kind of situation, that it needs to be rewritten. It needs to include this drama, not only the drama that went on in Tulsa, Oklahoma, mm-hmm. but it needs to include Juneteenth. It needs to include the travesty. Listen, this country was just not found or discovered by Columbus.
Right.
It was swindled right out from, there was a Native American population here.
Yes.
That colonialists, not only British colonials, Spanish colonials, and French colonials, wiped out 90% of the Native population. Let's not get it twisted here. There is a systemic situation going on that will eradicate you if you are not careful.
Right.
They will wipe you off the face of the earth as if you never existed. Because while I have no proof of it, I can bet you dimes to dollars that there are whole tribes, languages, cultures that have disappeared and erased from the face of the earth, and it is all at the hands of another man. I really don't like making it a white and black thing and blah blah blah. I'd rather make it about good and evil and the fight between right and wrong. And unfortunately, there are individuals that just can't see when they've been doing wrong and want to turn around and stop and make it right. I'm one of those individuals that for decades, because of my alcoholism and my drug addiction, I did a lot of wrong. See, I'm big enough that I can admit that today. And because of a 12-step program, I turned around, I stopped. Didn't happen all at once, but I at least stopped with the drugs and the alcohol, and I did an inventory, and I started making right some of my wrongs. Now, there's an unfortunate situation. Some of these people that I have wronged have long since passed from this existence. And in those situations, I do living amends. Now, those are personal things that I do that I don't make public because it does not serve me to tell you what I'm doing when I make it public. But I do things that make my conscience feel better. And I offer that up to a memory that I feel guilty about. And I'm able to face the day with a clearer conscience. And I'm grateful for that process. I am tremendously grateful for that process. And let's say that I turn around and I look at Danny and I says, "You dirty bitch." And I said that unfoundedly. I am so sorry. At the end of the day, I get to review my actions, and I get to look at Danny, and I get to say, "I'm so sorry. It was in the heat of the moment. Is there something I can do to make it right? Would you like another cup of coffee?" Huh? No?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay. So, but you, I get that opportunity, and I'm hoping that eventually some of my white brothers and sisters will see that and get that opportunity also and do something better with their lives, you know? So that Juneteenth thing and the systemic prejudices that are going on really need to be dissected and addressed on multiple levels. It really does. We're going to incorporate that later in a later discussion about disclosure, but right at the moment I'm going to change subjects because I'm trying to keep my eye on the time, keep my focus on the time. We're in phase three now here in Los Angeles, and in LA. Phase three means that they have opened up restaurants, nail salons, and the mall. And I think movie theaters are next?
I think so.
Movie theaters are next. Now, I believe that you work somewhere, right? You want to tell the audience where you work at?
Yeah, so I currently work at El Proyecto del Barrio. It's a nonprofit organization. I work in the prevention and education field, so that has to do with HIV and overall sexual health. So there's that.
So is COVID-19 part of that you know, exposure population? I mean, if you're having sex, maybe we're French kissing. Could I catch COVID-19 this way?
Most definitely.
Oh my gosh. So is your organization concerned about, do you guys do testing for COVID-19?
We currently don't do testing for COVID-19.
Oh.
But it is, like you mentioned, kind of course, more exposure for us. We are also connected with the clinic, just in case, because it is for prevention as well as health in general. So there are a lot of patients that are seen at this clinic, and because of that, we also have a larger amount of people that are coming in and out, especially dealing with health concerns, which at the moment, a lot of more people have been showing up with having had exposure to coronavirus or having had coronavirus themselves at one point. So, I mean, it's still happening. The fact that these phases are kind of moving at more of a faster pace kind of paints a picture of what it is that the government's ideals, where they lie, which would be the again, capitalistic ideals in terms of we're losing money, we need to do something about it, rather than prioritizing the health of the citizens, you know, which is currently, of course, not happening. It's happening, but to a degree that's kind of like, it's just not as big a scale as it should be in order to minimize possible transmission. So, yeah, I mean, it's kind of, I mean, personally, of course, I want things to go back to normal, but the reality of it is that it's not normal right now, you know? And,
Do you guys have a plan for some type of normalcy to start happening in some kind of way? Do you think that will happen in any way, shape, or form, maybe?
Well, right now it's just abiding by the standards set by the CDC, you know, like whatever it is that they say, which is why we're currently in phase three kind of thing, is happening. The plan is just to keep following those rules. Even though personally I hate wearing the mask, but it is, and even right now, I mean, like, you know, we're kind of like a little sample of the idea that many more people have become lax with wearing a mask. And I think you brought up a good point in the idea that, well, if it's not happening to me personally, or if I don't visually see something with my own two eyes, then it must not be happening. You know?
Well, I get that, you know, for me, I didn't know anybody for the longest time that hadn't had COVID-19. And maybe, I would say maybe about last month when I started this page, all of a sudden it started trickling in. I started finding people closer to my group,
right,
of friends that had been exposed to COVID-19.
Right.
Now, many of them, for whatever reason, have told me it wasn't as bad as what they're saying on the news.
Right.
It does not diminish the fact that there's still a body count going on with COVID-19.
Right.
And I just think, you know, even though we're in phase three, I still, you know, there are certain precautions that I take, you know. Unfortunately, though, around my friends, they become relaxed, you know. This is a problem.
Mm-hmm.
This is a big problem. And I would imagine if I was sexually active, oh my God, it would be even a bigger problem.
Mm-hmm.
Because for sex to happen, it's going to have to really be relaxed. I don't know if kissing would be fun with a mask on. And I remember back in the 80s, you know, when they told us, you know, condoms were the only form of protection, it was really hard to get the gay population to wear condoms.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I worked in a population where, you know, I was a prostitute, and no glove, no love, you know? And I used to, in my disclosure, which is our next topic that we're going to be talking about, in my disclosure, I would look at men and I would say, I don't know who you are, I don't know what you have, nor do I care. I do know this. This little latex condom will protect me from you and you from me. And so we're just going to use it because it doesn't matter what you say out of your mouth.
Right.
Because I don't know how many men would tell me, we don't have to use that. I don't have it.
Nope. Right.
Let me tell you something. We don't use this. You don't have it, you're going to catch it real soon.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's how it's transmitted.
Right.
By not using the protection that they say to you. Bo, what do you think you're doing? My trusty little hound there is going through things, you know? But yes, this, you know, these are the things that, you know, we would deal with. And it was just one of those things, you know?
Right. Well, it's just like, right now it is just a preventative measure. Thinking of everybody as positive kind of helps again to practice those safety measures, where at the moment a lot of people, or the virus is known to be also asymptomatic, which means that there are no present symptoms.
Oh my goodness! Asymptomatic!
So somebody might be a carrier and not really knowing, you know, like, and if this somebody is someone that chooses not to wear a mask, then they are unknowingly transmitting it to whoever they might come into contact with. And just because it didn't become bad for that person, doesn't mean that it won't be bad for the next person that it was transmitted to. So those safety measures are kind of just in place so that they don't, you know, like, pass them on, you know, like. But there are a number of people that are exercising their right to not wear a mask out in public or in more tighter public spaces where there are a lot more of a population there. So the risk of course contracting or transmitting is that much greater. Which is why it's kind of like uneasy in terms of going through the phases as quickly as we are.
Well, it's because they say the numbers are on the rise.
Of course, yeah.
You know, and here we are in the middle of June, you know, and have you heard anything from the CDC? Are we any closer to a vaccine?
No, not personally, I don't know.
And they don't inform you at work, that, you know, to how to update and maybe keep your clients a little bit calmer about this situation? Because I'm sure you deal with individuals that are absolutely paranoid. Do you deal with drug addicts?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And those are the worst. I don't know about you, but those individuals, I mean, you're dealing with a whole different kind of population when you're dealing with them.
Right. Well, again, it's just following the procedures set by the CDC in terms of wearing a mask in close contact with anybody that might come visit us at the clinic, trying to maintain a little bit of distance in the workspace from our coworkers. And then, since we do provide HIV testing for HIV, when we're close with them and administering the test, we're also wearing the face shields. Ask that they also wear a mask and get their temperature checked before entering the facility in order to ensure some kind of feeling of
that safety and security.
Yeah, like a little bit of control that we're doing something about it, you know.
Wow, you guys are really on the front line.
Yeah.
You are. That's you know, honorable work. So how many thousands of dollars are you making a week for doing such things?
Well, currently no visible bonuses have been given.
Oh, yeah. I see.
Which again, paints a picture of what kind of capitalist America looks like.
Do you think that because it is a nonprofit and the population that you are addressing, that maybe there is some systemic prejudice going on when it comes to funding for your organization?
I mean, yes. If it's a non-profit and you're not making any profit, then kind of contributes to the general wealth of America, then I'm not going to look at you as a businessman and say, oh, this is where the money is, you know, where it's always about numbers and money and what you can make in terms of profit. So, no, that's where a little bit of the prejudice comes towards the nonprofit organizations and receiving funding for much needed services such as HIV testing, which allow for prevention and better education towards the general community in which it affects. You know? But because there's already been cutbacks in terms of some of the services that we provide, thankfully it's not the HIV testing, but in terms of the STD testing, some of that has been cut back and there's been greater limitations, which is people are going to be having sex, people are going to unfortunately catch something, you know. So if we don't have the kind of services provided, then these things are going to become more of a problem. And because it's in concern of the general health and all that stuff, and not really concerned about making more money, there's going to be sort of a bias in whether or not somebody's going to look at helping, you know, like in a humanitarian effort rather than like, well, how am I going to make money off of this?
I can see that as being a very systemic kind of issue.
Yeah.
So let's start segueing into disclosure, you know, which is a topic that's kind of spilling over from last week into this week, you know, and there is this documentary on Netflix about disclosure, which I watched last night. I found it very, very interesting. You know, especially when it comes to transgenders in the public eye, you know, the first thing that they are always asking a transgender, you know, transgender male to female is, where do you hide it, you know, which is a very offensive, you know, question to ask a transgender, you know, for many years, you know, I use duct tape. Sometimes I would even, because my hormone levels were so high and it was so limp, I could just take and invert it and I would crazy glue it shut and, you know, there would be some flaps of skin hanging out and it would look like a vagina, you know? So, I mean, as far as I was concerned, I, you know, came up with some crafty little ways on how to hide my junk.
Oh my God.
And you know, I have worked in strip clubs, you know, where I would be dancing totally nude in front of a man and they had absolutely no clue as to what was right in front of them. You know, and I'm not and in that stage of my life, I was not willing to disclose anything for fear that they might try and kill me.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a very powerful thing when you believe what you see, you know. So for many, many of us, many transgender women, we are just so believable and passable that that question, that conversation doesn't even come up. Mm-hmm. But so, you know, one of the topics that I've suggested today is about disclosure. When, where, why, and how. And this disclosure is straight across the board in the dating scene. Mm-hmm. So, and I posed to you earlier today. So you're out in public, let's say that you're doing HIV testing, let's say that you're out there on Hollywood Boulevard.
Oh my.
This is a diverse population,
yes.
Right? And you've got a diverse crowd. Let's say you stumble across, I don't know, just some young man, very hot, and he is coming for some HIV testing, but you don't know his sexual orientation. How would you handle maybe asking an individual like this out on a date and disclosing? Are you forward enough that this would be the place you would do such a thing?
Probably not.
Really? Oh, I'm so sorry.
Personally, I've never really asked anyone on a date. And that's not to say that there are people asking me on dates, because that's not happening.
I don't believe that.
So I think it just starts off with treating them as another individual first. You know, like they are another person. It's just so kind of just talking. It doesn't necessarily have to be like, hey, I'm interested in you. Would you like to go do something? You know, like kind of just starting figuring out who they are and letting them figure out who I am.
Oh, I see, because now I know that, you know, In my world, we don't just hop in the sack right away. But I forgot, in gay relationships, 10 minutes past knowing each other,
okay.
And you guys are naked, aren't you?
Ideally.
Ideally, I see. I see.
Yeah.
I see. And the second date is with a U-Haul truck, right? From my understanding.
I would hope so.
I see.
Hasn't happened yet.
Okay.
I think that kind of gives into, like, these are behaviors practiced because, like, homosexuality and the LGBTQ community kind of being...
Use an I statement. Don't do that.
Okay. So
reason I say that you use an I statement and don't project onto the entire community, it's because this community is so diverse.
Right.
And I don't want to offend any particular community.
Okay.
With what you're getting ready to say.
All right.
Which should be an I statement.
All right. So I personally have felt that I've always kind of had to hide who I really am as much as I could. You know, like, because there's just a...
Hide what? What is it that you think you're hiding?
Well, what I hoped to hide.
I see, because I can spot that you're as queer as a $3 bill, honey.
Thank goodness.
Yes.
And that's definitely a plus for me and anyone else that might not be as, you know, obvious.
Do you find people that are surprised when they find out?
No.
You know, that, whoo, you're gay? Whoo, surprise! You find people like...
But, like, I mean, it might have just been a lie. But in terms of, even though there are,
Now see, for me, that's happened. When I disclosed that I'm transgender, or that I was born a man,
right.
I mean, some people are so floored by it.
Yeah.
I can see that it has shaped the foundation mm-hmm. of their world.
Yeah.
It's why I don't do anything about my voice, mm-hmm. you know? It is the exact reason why I don't do anything about my voice. Because, in general, that should be your first clue. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not going to go out into the world and walk up to people and
right.
announce to the cashier at the CVS, guess what, honey? I am a transgender woman. I was once a man. Can I get a 10% discount for that? I'm not doing all of that. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
I'm just going to go on with the entire illusion. There's no reason for her to know my business that way.
Yeah.
When I worked at Pierce College, I didn't walk up to a student and disclose that particular fact. There was no reason, no business in me talking about what's going on in my panties.
Right.
Nobody's business. You see what I'm saying? So, for me, that disclosure of when, where, and why really came into play. Mm-hmm. The how for me was easy. I never had a problem with disclosure. Mm-hmm. You know? But the where, when, and why I was disclosing certainly was a very important factor in my disclosure to individuals. Mm-hmm. It had to be.
Right. Well, I guess the, like... Yeah.
And like I said, I speak with an I statement.
Yeah.
Because for other transgender women, it's totally different.
Well, I guess for me, like, for my homosexuality, I am grateful that there are more characteristics, I guess, that have been categorized as leaning towards, you know, being gay. So, even if I didn't overtly say it, like, or, like, verbally say that, like, I'm gay, that it was more, like, inferred through by other people.
Gesture?
Other people can just kind of assume. You know, so I didn't, I guess what I'm trying to say is that growing up, I always had more of a problem accepting it myself, where I'm grateful that it was more visible to others, because it allowed me to grow into it, rather than if I were to be able to hide it a little better.
So nobody, when you were growing up, nobody ever told you, but sweetie, you've got sugar in the tank.
I mean,
you know, I mean, I have friends that are always telling me that, you know, that they're straight or they're a top or something like that. And I looked at them and I said, but darling, you've got so much sugar in your tank, you know? That corn syrup back there, baby. You're just oozing with honey, you know? Yes.
I think it's just, I mean, they didn't say it as politely.
They called you the F word, didn't they?
And variations thereof.
Oh my goodness. That is rough. When I was growing up, I was called a lot of names. But you know what? I knew how to flip a bird and call people names back, you know, and I was good at that too, you know. And I always say, you know, walk around with your head up high, defend yourself the best way you can, and keep walking to the beat of a different drum. I admire that. But for me, that takes a different kind of courage, you know. And I think that, you know, I love a lot of the ideals that the American dream is built on. Mind you, I realize the American dream and American reality are two different things.
Yes.
I work to strive closer towards dream and reality. Because I'm going to tell you something. When I was a kid, I dreamed that one day I would be a woman. Mm-hmm. And today, that is my reality. So, I am living proof that dreams can come true. And I dream of a better America. And I'd like to believe that in my lifetime, that reality can come true. It has to happen here through unification. And it has to stop with this dividing of brown and black and yellow and red Americans. See, because that's what the white man calls us. That red American is the native population, the original Americans of this country. The yellow are the Asian, Pacific Islander. I don't even like all of that. I hate that we use, you know, these references when we're talking about Americans. I think we're all just Americans, you know. But you know, because of whatever reason, we have these African American, Latino Americans, these subcategories that divide us.
Right.
And I think if you want to divide us into these groups, then these groups need to unite together and find a common purpose. Because this is a systemic issue that is keeping us down and under a thumb. And I don't know about you, but I don't like this thumb. Don't like it. It's got a hangnail on it and it's rubbing me the wrong way. My name is Francesca Oz. You are?
Danny Suazo.
Danny Suazo. This was Live with Hot Topics, Bluesy Touches. Thank you so much for joining us. And we'll see you next Sunday. Same bougie channel, same bougie time.